My turn.
Yes.
Evans, thank you. And good evening once again to Ato and to our viewers back home. I'm not sure in the last 10 minutes as I listened to him, I got a sense of how much of the 10 billion is coming from where and how much they as GOG, if they become GOG, are able to put up. I don't know if you got that sense. He just said the money is there, it's how you raise
specifically,
it. I'll come back to
specifically,
it.
He hasn't addressed the specifics of where the money is going to come from.
But I explained in to the you, last he 10 have minutes. He has two legs.
One is social.
And then indeed, and what we're saying, the social will not exceed 3 billion.
Is it? So 3 the billion is...
It's just 25% of that.
The 7 billion is self-financing.
So,
completely.
So,
you have used 8 billion for consumption.
No, no,
and
no. I can use 3 billion of that. Before I even start. So what you're saying is that 7 billion from private investors.
You see, private investors is a generic word. I don't want you to use that word.
Okay, so what should
self-financing I'm talking about.
What does that mean?
You see, self-financing is you can create a special purpose vehicle. A vehicle that can borrow on its own balance sheet. A vehicle that can invest and in the end pay on its own. Just like we have the Tema, what do you call it? The airport company.
The Kotoka International
and
Airport.
And it's paying for itself. So it is not just private, but we're saying
done,
it can do.
Let's hear it. When I'm done, I'll show you from page 25 of their manifesto where he's hiding the answers. What essentially they are not telling the Ghanaian people is that if they get the mandate, what they are going to end up doing is to leverage the Ghana Infrastructure Investment Fund, securitize it, borrow 10 billion to add to our contingent liability, and hope to put it to this kind of
use. In fact, it's
implicit.
I flagged that is all going around. Let me quote that. It says, restore the transfer of 2.5 million percentage points of existing VAT to the Ghana Infrastructure Investment Fund.
Yes. And then
the gift was established by the job, and it goes into has the potential to create 1 million jobs. We'll come to that because that's one of the things I really want to interrogate.
So, let me have my turn.
What is wrong with that?
I will come to that. But you see, you should be upfront with the Ghanaian people that, listen, what we really seek to do is that if we get the mandate, we will seek to securitize GIIF and raise 10 billion and hope to use it for infrastructure. And then we can get into the consequent analysis of debt sustainability, its impact, and all of those ones. But this social and self-financing, and then when you ask about private investors, is going around in circles. But I'll come to it. First of all, Evans, we cannot have a conversation about manifestos and the future without answering first the question of who is talking and what is his track record. There's no doubt that Ghana's economy will require a medium-term recovery program between 2021 and 2024 because COVID has shaken all that we have achieved in the last 3 years, not just us. The global ecosystem has been shaken from Germany to the UK, to the US, to Japan. Global economies have been shaken because of COVID. So it stands to reason that post-2021 to 2024, we will need an economic recovery program in the medium term to get back on track. Mm. Now, we will need that because in the last 3.5 years, or in the last 3 years or so, everybody agrees that Ghana was doing a yeoman's job. If you take the macro indicators, the fiscals, if you take the real sector growth, if you take its impact on the average life of the Ghanaian, we were doing a yeoman's job. Our friends on the other side continuously contested it. But over and over again, anybody who was very good at this game, following the numbers, would once again make that point clearly that Ghana had recovered and was on a good track. It's COVID that has dealt us a blow. But if there's somebody to recover this economy, it's not our colleagues on the other side. And you've seen how even their big push, my good friend is struggling to explain how they intend to go about this good push argument. Very simply put, the first time they talked about a $10 billion infrastructure program aimed at delivering any sort of benefit to the people of Ghana was during the era of Mr. Mahama when they sold us the idea of the Hope City. It may sound like a funny subject, but that was the first time they sold us a $10 billion infrastructure program.
But that's a private...
No, it was a public-private partnership. When Mr. Mahama came to cut sword around Wager, explaining to us how self-financing, the same expression, which is why I threw him the bait of, is it private investors? Is it self-financing? They were going to build this infrastructure. It was going to lead to technology and jobs, etc. Mm. And by the time they were leaving power, beyond the sword cutting, not much had happened. I want to take you to the 2012 manifesto, very simply, and look at their big infrastructure plan. And you tell me how much it differs from what he has just told us this evening. And then we can make a determination whether or not any of the things that they are talking about are even worth paying attention to. And if you go to their part of the manifesto that deals with, take roads and railways. You've heard him talk about roads and railways. So, for example, they say they are going to do the Eastern Corridor Tema Isikuma, Hohohoi Jasikan, Yendi Narerugu, Kulungungu with Nkwanta.
Which document are you quoting from?
I'm quoting from their 2012 manifesto.
2012.
Yeah, yeah. Which they implemented from 2012 to 2016.
They have 4 years
to 4 years to implement. And they say Eastern Corridor Tema Isikuma, Hohohoi Jasikan, Yendi Narerugu, Kulungungu with Nkwanta in the Volta region. Please listen to this. As an inland port. Mm. You've heard him talking about ports and why it's important to connect these ports. You would ask yourself, where are these projects? They never did them. Take the Western Corridor. And they talked about Elubu, Asemkrum, Enchi, Gosu, Sunyai, Bamboi, Boli, Wahamile, with Gambia number 2 in the Brong-Ahafo region as an inland port. Where is it? After 4 years. They said Central Spine, Accra, Kumasi, Techiman, Tamale, Bogatanga, Paga, with Buankra in the Ashanti region as an inland port. We are now working on the Buankra project. They had 4 years. Then on railways, they waxed very lyrical about it. I don't want to even go too much into it. So the first thing that comes to mind when you hear them talking about the big push, where they are even hiding the source of funding of the 10 billion, is what is their credibility when it comes to similar conversations? And it is quite clear that the last time they made similar promises to the people of Ghana, these promises, by the time they were leaving power, had not been touched. So the question that the average Ghanaian asks, because your proposition was that in the end, the Ghanaian will have to make a decision
where to pitch
their tent. And the question the Ghanaian will be asking themselves is that, are these people that I can even bank my hopes on when they start talking about big pushes and all of that? Thirdly,
before I come to thirdly, on the general subject of capital expenditure,
yes,
this is a government that is track record on that in terms of infrastructural investment.
Yes.
It's unparalleled compared to yours.
We dispute that. I'll come to
that. You do?
We do.
I just want to cite you one example.
I will come to that. If I just may land with my argument,
please
I'll come
do,
to that.
Because we interrogate.
I will come to that. Now, secondly, about 4 years ago, when they mooted this whole infrastructure argument, they said they were going to set up the Ghana Infrastructure Investment Fund, GIF, which they did, backed it by law, and made the argument that it was going to be the panacea to our infrastructure problem.
Which you have refused to fund,
today,
by the way.
Well, because we have a different proposition to it. And
but there's a law.
That.
There's a law that says fund it for 2 consecutive years. You've refused to put money in the GIF.
Yeah, they passed the law to ban Okada. Did they implement it?
No,
we passed the law. No.
So I'm you're saying
passed,
that.
No, because so governments make
because
choices.
Because somebody breached the law,
no,
it's okay for the NDC
choices. Governments make choices. We passed the law for the Venture Capital Trust Fund. How much did they fund it? So that's a different debate. I'll come to that. Now, one of the things that needs to be answered in this new proposition is what happens to GIF? Is GIF being abandoned? Is this a complement to GIF?
They're enhancing GIF.
I'm coming. Or is it the reality that what they are seeking to do is to use GIF to leverage and borrow? And essentially, and you have just done analysis of where our debt position is today.
Yes.
And how come anybody seeking the realms of power should be mindful about generating revenues and not burdening the already burdened status of our national economy? And it's important for them to be clear on some of these things. But be that as it may, the MPP has an alternative argument when it comes to building the Ghanaian economy or to rebuilding the Ghanaian economy. First of all, in the last 3.5 years before COVID hit, we have demonstrated clearly that we have the competencies to restore macro stability, different from what we inherited from them. And the numbers, I mean, I think you've gone over and over, and again, I'm not too sure if your viewers are even interested in these numbers anymore, but the numbers speak for themselves. If you take, for example, the macro numbers, take growth. And it's not just about President Akufo-Addo and President Mahama specific. It's about the MPP and the NDC. If you take growth, 2008, old series, Akufo was ending around 9.1%. President Mills, the old President Mills, did 11%, did 14% in 2011.
Very specific, yeah.
That was his last full fiscal year. Mr. Mahama ended up at 3.4% in 2016. And the MPP administration is the one that brought it back up to 6.5. When you start talking macro, because you know all of this conversation that we're having is about who has the ability to deliver a strong macro foundation, generate good fiscals out of it, and use those fiscals to invest in the real sector, therefore ensuring that you have jobs, you have incomes, and you have further opportunity for Ghanaian people. Take, for example, non-oil GDP. President Mills did 8.2, because you recall that at the time, President Akufo, we didn't have non-oil GDP per se, so everything was composite. President Mills did 8.2. President Akufo, because it was all together, did 9.1. President Mahama dropped down from President Mills' 8.2 to 4.6. We are the ones who brought it down to 5.8 in 2019. If you like, go into the specifics. If you take agriculture, for example, President Akufo left agriculture 7.4. President Mills took it down to 0.8. 2016, they brought it to 2.9. Now we've brought it back up to 4.6, planting for food and jobs, rearing for export and rural development, planting for export and rural development, rearing for food and jobs. So the macro numbers themselves show clearly who has demonstrated a certain track record. We don't believe that restructuring the Ghanaian economy is about putting all your attention and your emphasis on, for example, one segment, i.e., let's say construction, and seeking to do, for example, a $10 billion investment in construction. And by the way, if you look at there are 1 million jobs, if you read page 25, the devil is in the detail there. Those 1 million jobs they are talking about are supposed to be from those construction activities.
How you don't know what you're talking about?
It is there.
You don't know. We'll come to the jobs question.
It's there in page 25. I've read it.
We'll come to the jobs question.
So if you broaden it, if I just may land, when it comes to agriculture, when it comes to industry, when it comes to services, we have a demonstrated track record between them and us. A, who delivers on their promises, and B, who delivers better numbers in these areas.
Yeah, but
so we don't begrudge them for their refreshed $10 billion infrastructure plan, which, as I have tried to demonstrate to you,
I hope you've made a lot of
really not new.
There's a lot to respond
but
to.
But we have a clear alternate proposition, and as we go through the MPP, I'll have an opportunity.
Which is a curse. I want you in the next 2 minutes, lay out the curse for me, because you also have the same challenge with funding that. In fact, yours is even more ambitious. And for a government in power, knowing the analysis we just did with the fiscal constraints that we currently have with COVID, I'm surprised to learn that you want to spend 100 billion cedis in 3 years.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
That's not all. And let's start with the immediate. Let's start with the immediate, because that's the one that really got me scratching my head. Between July this year and December, you are projecting to spend almost 2.8 billion.
Yes.
To kickstart the economy, yes. Somewhat. I mean, yes. Specific areas.
Yes. Okay.
We are 2 months to the end of the year.
Yes.
Where's the funding? Where is the funding? Well, we haven't seen it.
No. Well, today and I think yesterday or so, the Bank of Ghana Monetary Policy Committee has been going through their numbers, and perhaps may even be a better, may I say, arbiter in these matters beyond we the politicians. But specifically, if you take the 2020 appropriation as revised, we're looking at over 100 billion Ghana cedis. The appropriation for 2020 alone is over 100 billion Ghana cedis. Mm. So if you have an administration that is saying that in a three-year period, in a medium-term period, it seeks to spend 100 billion cedis.
Dollars.
It is not, no, that
comes so 100 billion cedis, but that comes down to some around 20 billion.
No, I'm coming. I'm saying. Because first of all, the argument is that, wow, 100 billion cedis, why are you going to get
that's a
it?
Lot of money.
And I'm coming to that. I'm saying that this year alone, the government of Ghana is spending 100 billion cedis.
What you fail to acknowledge is that, talking about this year. But yes. No, sorry, if you may.
I haven't explained the CARES program.
I'll come to that. But just a point, because this is central to the CARES
program. Yes.
Same question I just asked him about what the OECD is saying.
Yes.
Everything you're saying must be factored within the COVID environment.
Absolutely.
So the fact that you managed to, appropriate, 10 billion, 100 billion?
100 billion cedis this year, COVID year.
But COVID's implications is going to run for the next projections.
But I am coming to that specific point that, therefore, it is not strange. You know, their $10 billion in today's terms is about 60 billion cedis.
True.
Mr. Mahama, in his own words, says that he borrowed 54 billion cedis in his four-year tenor. Those are his words, not mine. In fact, he tries to make an argument comparing nominal GDP year on year, and everybody knows we never do that in economics because you haven't adjusted for inflation, but that's a different debate. So they are talking of about 60 billion cedis. I'm saying to you that this year alone, the government of Ghana has spent 100 billion. So it's not strange if the government says that over a three-year period, it will spend 100 billion in some specific areas. Now that 100 billion is broken into two parts.
Let's go.
There's about a 30 billion that the government of Ghana seeks to make available to raise and to appropriate. And I'm giving you the example that this year alone, we have done 100 billion. So 30 billion is not out of the woods. Now, the other 70 billion, we are quite clear in our minds that we are doing it, and we are clear. We are not leveraging some tax revenue
private sector
to create debt.
Yeah.
We are doing clear public-private partnership. And I'm going to demonstrate it to you. There are a number of areas that we believe you need to invest in to get this Ghanaian economy back on track and flying full throttle. And we don't believe that you box it all in.
No,
agree.
I'm going to go there.
Because
I've not read our manifesto carefully.
Oh, I have read.
You haven't. And so
I have
point you
that's why I'm quoting you from pages.
Point you to
that's why I'm quoting your pages.
So I'm going to quote the pages to
please
you.
Do.
But let me tell you something.